Yeah, thank you very much for coming to the Pakistan Embassy and giving me an opportunity to be on your network. As you know, that coronavirus is a global challenge. It is impacting all countries with varying degrees of impact and effect. Given the size of Pakistan's population, we are, mashallah, a nation of 210 million plus people. The impact of the pandemic has been relatively mild. Our latest figures, if I am correct, is about that we have about 34,000 cases, of which about 9,000 have recovered. Our deaths are 737. In the last 5 or 6 days, we have lost on average about 24 lives, which compares, of course, you cannot put a price on human life, but these figures compare very favorably with other countries, particularly those in the West. In terms of the second part of your question, what Pakistan is doing to combat this pandemic, we have a comprehensive strategy. We have created a national command and operation center, which is overlooking and overseeing the national response to this pandemic. There are three main elements of our strategy to fight coronavirus. These elements are social, health, and economic. In terms of social, the government has taken a very comprehensive and extensive measures to make our public aware of the problem and how to deal with it and how to avoid it. We have undertaken social distancing exercises. There are lockdowns as required. There is a very comprehensive system of testing and tracking contacts of patients. We are trying to limit the number of people gathering at various places. The domestic and international flights, for instance, were suspended, and we are taking these decisions not as one size fits all, but depending on the dynamics of the pandemic in particular areas of the country. On the health side, we are bolstering our hospital capacity. We have a significant number of ICU beds available, where there's ventilators, etc., available for those who are requiring that. People who are coming from abroad, we are quarantining them, we are testing them, and only once their tests turn negative are they allowed to join the community. At the same time, on the economic side, which is the third part of our strategy, the Prime Minister has announced a very comprehensive package of assistance to the most deserving segments of the population whose economic condition is adversely impacted by the lack of economic activity on account of the pandemic. The effort is to make a comprehensive, mutually reinforcing elements of this strategy, and all of this is of course coordinated by the National Command and Operation Center, as I've just told you. Well, all countries in the world right now are facing difficulties in terms of having the appropriate number of or amount of the various equipments and machinery parts and things required to deal with this pandemic. Pakistan is not an exception. We have a big population, but our situation is somewhat better in the sense that, number one, the disease is not as prevalent and as virulent as in other parts of the world, given the size of our population. And nevertheless, of course, there are so many things that you require to deal with this pandemic: protective clothing, masks, particularly high quality masks, ventilators, other equipment. Pakistan is more or less doing well, but at the same time, we are also fortunate that we have received assistance from our friendly countries, particularly Turkey and China, who have provided us with PPE equipment, masks, protective clothing, shoe covers, and other things. So right now we are relatively well placed. We have a significant number of ICU units, about 5,000 available in Pakistan, and they are not yet at full capacity. If my data is correct, I think as of yesterday, 134 patients were in ICUs, and the number on ventilators was even less. In terms of our health system, we are a mix of public and private health system. technically all Pakistanis are entitled to a reasonable degree of affordable medical care, health care at state expense. In this particular case, dealing with the pandemic, we have created special units. Special hospitals have been designated as dedicated to pandemic, to dealing with coronavirus. The treatment is free, and as our testing system right now, we have a capacity of about 20,000 tests a day. So we are geared, given our resources, our population, and the extent of the pandemic, we believe that we are relatively well placed to deal with this issue, and all elements of our health system are working as we had thought that they would be. Well, it's not more regions as such. It is more or less evenly spread out in the country. Our bigger problem, we have seen is that Pakistanis who are being repatriated from abroad back home, there's a very high percentage of those who have been testing positive for coronavirus. I was just seeing the newspapers this morning, and I think one of the flights that came, a few flights that came in the last few days, more than 300 patients, corona positive passengers were found in them. So that is our main problem. Of course, when they arrive in Pakistan, as I've explained, we have a stringent policy of quarantine. They are kept in quarantine, they are tested while in quarantine, and only they are allowed to join their families and go home if their tests come out negative. If, of course, their tests come out positive, then they're properly quarantined, and if their symptoms develop, then we take them to the hospitals depending on the severity of their system. I would hope so. Unfortunately, I'm not an epidemiologist, so I cannot give you an authoritative response on that, but we believe so. We are contemplating a very graduated, sophisticated, gradual opening up, because as you understand that while we must deal with this pandemic, we must also deal with the economic fallout of this pandemic, and to ensure that the deserving sections of the population, particularly those whose employment and livelihood is threatened, also do not suffer unduly. So I'm optimistic. We hope that now that the curve is leveling off, and we should be gradually returning to normalcy. Well, thank you very much for, in fact, asking this very relevant question. Yes, the situation in Indian occupied Kashmir is terrible, and it is terrible on account of two things. Even without coronavirus, the situation defies description. For instance, Kashmiris have been under internet communications, social media lockdown now since August 2019. This is the longest period any group of people in the world have been deprived of their basic human right of freedom of expression and opinion. And this is the first step of the oppression that the Indian state is imposing on the Kashmiris. Then the subsequent higher steps are young people are being killed, the political leadership is in prison, the fundamental rights of the Kashmiris to freedom of movement are denied, people cannot even go to the hospitals, the schools have been closed, there are daily reports of extrajudicial and summary executions. Particularly young men, are being tortured. When the Kashmiris are able to come out and they protest and they demand their rights, lethal force is used against them. Particularly, those pellet guns are used, which fire small pellets which blind the people. In fact, Kashmir has the largest concentration right now in the world of people who have been unnaturally blinded. These are all things that were happening before the coronavirus. And of course, there is the political dimension in which the autonomy of Kashmir and the disputed status of Kashmir has been diluted by the Indian state by removing whatever little constitutional guarantees there were in the Indian constitution for the rights of the Kashmiris. And the corona pandemic has just made the situation of the Kashmiris worse. It is ironic that when the world is faced with a crisis such as a health pandemic, as a pandemic, the natural tendency of the world is to set aside their political differences and to work together to mitigate the impact of such a pandemic. But unfortunately, India has used this pandemic to further its own agenda of oppression and repression against the Kashmiris. The internet blockage is stopping Kashmiris from getting the proper information about the pandemic. The restriction on the movement is stopping Kashmiris from accessing health facilities on account of suffering from coronavirus. The attention of the world is diverted towards dealing with the crisis of coronavirus, and India is increasing its oppression using this opportunity and this diversion of the world attention to further increase its oppression. There have been a number of young Kashmiri men who have been extrajudicially executed in the last month or so. And another dimension, very disturbing dimension, is that India has increased cross line of control firing from its territory into Pakistani territory to intimidate the population on our side also. I apologize for using this analogy, but it is like when there is a fire in a place and somebody who is intent on stealing something uses this confusion to do that theft. This unfortunately is how the Indian state is behaving in Kashmir during this very serious global pandemic. Again, it's a very relevant question, and no, Pakistan is not alone, to name one. Pakistan has the support and support of Turkey, a Turkish political leadership, President Erdogan himself, AK Party, and all Turks on this issue. And it is a credit to Turkey that it has not allowed allowed political expediency or its political interests to cloud its judgment about what is right and wrong. When I say we, I mean the embassy, the government, people of Pakistan are deeply indebted to Turkey for this principled position. The people in most parts of the world, not just the Muslim world, in fact, various parliaments, political parties, citizens, observers, academics, scholars, journalists have all spoken about the very disturbing trend that India has been exhibiting in the last particularly 2 years or so with regard to Muslims in India and with regard to oppression in Kashmir. These issues have gained a lot of coverage, attention, and the world knows that there is something really rotten happening in Kashmir. And there is regular reporting on it. Of course, we would like the governments to be more vocal about it. They should take the lead from their own people and to come out forthrightly and call a spade and say what is happening in Kashmir is unacceptable, and the Kashmiris should be given, number one, their human rights, and number two, their right of self-determination, which is the basis of the denial of which right is the actual reason for what is happening there. The OIC has been following this situation very closely and has come out with very strong statements and reports as the occasion demanded. But of course, when there is oppression, when the rights of people are being denied, no amount of criticism is enough and no amount of attention is enough. The objective should be not just to speak about it, but the objective should be to try to put an end to the injustice. Of course, there is a lot more that the world can do. There's a lot more that the OIC can do. There's a lot more that the Muslim countries can do. But at the same time, it is not like as if the plight of the Kashmiris is totally lost on the world. Yeah, I was saying that the OIC has been following this issue. Yes. But the thing is that attention needs to be put on the basic solution. Basic issue is that, of course, the world is speaking about it. It needs to speak more. But the basic problem has to be addressed, because of which all this crisis and tension is taking place. For instance, to give you, to elaborate the problem a little, there are United Nations Security Council resolutions relating to Kashmir and giving a very practicable solution to it. Just ask the Kashmiris through a UN administered plebiscite, what do they want? The Security Council is therefore, the members of the Security Council are therefore bound to take note of this situation and to address this situation. Well, there are various reasons for it. You understand these also. The world is a political arena. But at the same time, we believe it is the members of the Security Council, particularly the permanent five, are under an obligation to uphold the decisions that they themselves took. If they do that, a very big source of instability in South Asia and in the world will be eliminated, and even more importantly, the suffering of 10 million Kashmiris will finally come to an end. The international community and UN Security Council members need to strike the same balance of fairness and justice that Turkey has been able to do, that what is wrong is wrong, and Turkey clearly speaks about it. This is an example that other countries also need to follow. Finally, thank you very much for giving me this opportunity to speak on these issues that you have raised. I would like to wish all Turks, our brothers and sister Turks, all health, all safety, all security in these very difficult times. MashaAllah, Turkey has done very well, and we wish Turkey all prosperity, peace, progress, and in this very difficult time, all health. Thank you very much.